So today's video is another true crime one, but I'm not going to be talking about a specific case. I'm going to be talking about a more general subject that has fascinated me since I learned about it almost a decade ago. Forensics facilities around the world study human decomposition as it relates to homicide and have even worked with police to help solve crimes. Let's talk about body farms. So first off, what exactly are we talking about here? A body farm is defined as a research facility where human decomposition is studied in various settings as a way of objectifying timing and circumstances of death from human remains. Body farm obviously isn't the technical term for these facilities. They've been called things like anthropological research facilities, human decomposition facilities, forensics facilities, or some other variation involving the words forensic anthropology, forensics, or institute. From everything I've read, the staffs at these body farms don't seem to be too fond of the nickname, but it is the most succinct way to convey the term, so I'll just be calling them body farms or farms from here on out. Body farms are known for laying out corpses in various poses and conditions and doing experiments to learn about human decomposition. They also train cadaver dogs and provide training to police so they can see what a decomposing body looks like and possibly what it smells like. The most famous body farm in Knoxville, Tennessee also provides FBI and NCIS training. The work people do at these farms is extremely important. When investigating a murder, it's important to know things like a victim's time of death or how long they might have been buried wherever they're buried. Knowledge like this can give important information about the circumstances surrounding before or after a victim's death. Research at these farms could even help police clear murder suspects or find hidden graves. But who donates their body to a body farm? It's not exactly the first thing most of us think of when we think about a loved one's imminent death or even our own. In fact, when I asked my dad if he'd ever considered donating his body to one of these facilities, he laughed. There are a few different reasons why people might donate their bodies to a body farm. The most common seem to be things like wanting to make a positive contribution to science, wanting a natural burial, or being unwilling or unable to pay for funeral expenses. A lot of people choose body farms over other medical facilities because the requirements at these farms tend to be less stringent. A lot of bodies there are also unclaimed or unidentified. One particular facility in Texas has the bodies of people who died while being smuggled across the U.S.-Mexico border, I assume illegally. I don't believe these specific bodies are used in experiments on the farm. The staff there just works with police to help identify them. But I have seen reports from some farms of John and Jane Doe's being used at the farm. The history of body farms stretches all the way back to 1971, when Dr. William Bass arrived at the University of Tennessee, Knoxville. Dr. Bass served as a forensic anthropologist and wanted to expand the school's program to include a graduate program in addition to the undergrad one. He was given land pretty early on for bodies donated to the school, but didn't get the land for what's now known as the body farm until 1980. That year, Bass was called on by police when they found a Civil War grave that had been disturbed. They'd found a body in the grave that they thought was more recent and had been put in the grave in an effort to hide it. At first, Bass concluded that the body was newer because it was unusually well preserved. But after further analysis, he realized the body had been buried in an airtight casket, which helped slow decomposition, and it was actually the body of a Confederate soldier. I'm sure Bass and the police were relieved they didn't have a murder on their hands, but this incident made Bass realize just how little is known about human decomposition. He was able to acquire land from an abandoned farm, and the body farm came about the following year. The term body farm came about pretty early on and was apparently started by cops in Knoxville, but it wasn't made well known until Patricia Cornwell's novel of the same name, published in either 1994 or 1995. Different sources said different things. Cornwell reportedly worked with William Bass at one point, and I believe one of the characters in the novel is supposed to be loosely based on him. Some sources even said Cornwell coined the term body farm on her own, but regardless of how it actually came about, it was now mainstream. But Cornwell is not the only one who's written about body farms. Dr. William Bass and writer John Jefferson have written three nonfiction books and an entire body farm series together under the pen name Jefferson Bass. I've never read any of their books, but their body farm series looks like pretty typical crime fiction novels. And of course, I will leave links below to all of these books if you want to check them out. For a while, the Tennessee body farm was the only one of its kind, but there was a need for other facilities. Decomposition is affected by things like region and climate, and other body farms have started to open in other parts of the world. The next one to open up was at Western Carolina University in North Carolina in 2006. It was followed by two in Texas, one at Texas State University in 2008, and another at Sam Houston State University in 2009. Another opened up at Southern Illinois University, I believe in 2012, and another at Colorado Mesa University that same year. At 4,780 feet, the Colorado facility is the one at the highest altitude. This, along with the desert environment of the southwestern United States, affects decomposition. Another farm just opened at Northern Michigan University around 2017, the world's first cold weather body farm. In 2016, the first body farm outside the United States was opened. The Australian Facility for Taphonomic Experimental Research, or AFTER, is part of the University of Technology Sydney and lies just west of Sydney in New South Wales, Australia. In Australian summers, a body can fully decompose within just a few weeks, so this facility is important in the climate diversity. Another warm weather facility opened the following year in Florida. The Forensic Institute for Research, Security, and Tactical Training, or FIRST, isn't part of a school, but is supported by Pasco Hernando State College. It's also the country's first subtropical body farm. There are also plans for body farms in Wisconsin and the United Kingdom, though the latter has been in talks for several years and has never come about. I read about another planned facility in Pennsylvania, but I don't think that one ever came about either. I also read about another planned similar location in the Netherlands, though in this one, the bodies would all be buried in shallow graves. There are also plans for a farm in Canada. This one was started by Sherry Forbes, who also started the Australian facility. It was supposed to have opened in spring 2020, but that didn't happen, so I'm not sure when it actually will open. The facility is part of, or at least affiliated with, the Université de Québec à Trois-Rivières. I really hope I'm pronouncing that right, my French sucks. It's called the Secure Site for Research in Thanatology. Thanatology is the study of death and things associated with it. I assume the name comes from Thanatos, who is the personification of death in Greek mythology. So let's get to the really fun part. What do they do with these bodies at the body farms? Well, it depends on the location. Bodies may be laying out in the open, covered by cages, or exposed. They may or may not be clothed. Some may be floating in pools, laid out in cars and trees, covered with tarps, or put in garbage cans. Sometimes things like trash or animal bones are buried with bodies to see if the technology that's supposed to detect human bodies really works. Some bodies are wrapped in rugs, burned, or struck with objects. And different facilities carry out their own bizarre experiments. At one point, staff at the Tennessee farm was burying bodies under concrete because apparently people who kill their spouse tend to do this to hide the body. They've also buried bodies at different depths to see if decomposition is affected by that. Experiments at Texas State have included burying bodies under mattresses and seeing if ants can tell the difference between human and animal remains. And at the North Carolina facility, they work to see what kinds of plastic bags causes corpses to decompose the fastest. Apparently, it's black plastic bags. Who knew? But my personal favorite experiment was carried out at the Illinois facility and studied how lawnmowers affect skeletal remains. It was prompted when a lawnmower accidentally ran over two of their bodies because when life gives you lemons, apparently. But just like bodies in the wild, the bodies at these farms sometimes have to deal with unexpected animal visitors. The North Carolina facility had possum-eating bodies at one point. And a report from January 2020 says feral cats were seen eating corpses in Colorado. This is apparently pretty rare since cats prefer to hunt rather than scavenge. Since they were feral cats, I assume they were just really hungry. And several facilities see vultures picking bodies clean, sometimes within just a few hours. So that's all I have for you today on body farms. Some of these facilities do work with the police and have even been instrumental in helping solve crimes. So even though a lot of us look on them with a gruesome fascination, they are doing a lot of good as well. So let me know in the comments, would you ever donate your body to a body farm? I think it would be kind of cool to know that you were making a difference even after you were dead. Plus, the idea of a natural burial seems pretty appealing. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to like and share it. And for more dark content, I hope you'll consider subscribing and hitting that bell. Thanks for watching, and I will see you next time.